We've arrived, the final Sunday in Advent, the final Sunday in which we have an opportunity to prepare ourselves for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. He's so close, we can see it. He's Emmanuel, God with us. What a tremendous blessing that we have the opportunity to look with faith. Here is the one God promised. He came exactly as God said he would. That's our joy and that's our confidence as we worship Emmanuel, our Savior Jesus Christ, this morning. A good morning and a welcome to all of you. The organ music for today has been recorded, so there might be some timing issues. Listen carefully. There might be some note values that are slightly different than what you're used to. There might be a little longer pause between stanzas. Again, just listen carefully, and we'll join in singing those hymns together. If you're worshiping with us virtually, send me a text message or an email. That information is useful to me. Let's join our hearts and voices now in singing the opening hymn. Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. That a virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will speak and respond responsively this morning. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever.
With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations.
I will declare that your love stands firm forever.
And that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself.
The heavens praise your wonders, Lord.
Your faithfulness, too, in the assembly of the holy ones.
Who is like you, Lord God Almighty?
You, Lord, are mighty, and your faithfulness surrounds you.
Blessed are those who have learned to acclaim you,
who walk in the light of your presence, Lord.
They rejoice in your name all day long.
They celebrate your righteousness.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Today's second reading is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 1. Paul explains clearly just who the Savior is. True God, true man, our Savior from sin. This reading will serve later as our sermon text. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his Son, who as to his earthly life was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him we received grace and apostleship to call all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith for his name's sake. And you also are among those Gentiles who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be his holy people, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Telling Joseph that his wife would become the mother of the Savior. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Christ.
The congregation may be seated. Children, I'd like to forward for a short message. We'll sit over here today. I have a present here with me this morning. Do you have presents like this under a tree? Yeah. They're wrapped real nicely. And you wonder what's in those, don't you? Well, let's try to guess what's in this one.
A box.
What's inside the box? Well, how about if I give you some clues? It's part of Christmas, not Easter. It's part of the Christmas tree. It's not at the bottom. This is at the top.
A star,
yes, that's what it is. Here it is, a Christmas tree star. We put those at the top. Why do we put a star at the top of our Christmas trees?
The star that the wise men followed.
Yeah, when Jesus was born, there was a special star, and that's what the wise men followed to come and visit Jesus later. I gave you clues, and you were able to guess what's in there. This morning in our reading, our God gave us clues about the Savior. Did you hear him? He said, "A virgin will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel." Well, so the Virgin Mary, wow, there's a clue. And Emmanuel means God with us. Jesus would be a human being just like we are, but he also would be true God. And then the angel appeared to Joseph, right? And he said, "Joseph, Mary is your wife, and the child within her, that's the Savior. I want you to name him Jesus." Well, that's who we know Jesus is. He's our Savior from sin. You see, all these clues lined up just as God said they would. It was important for him to do that, because Jesus isn't just a nice gift. He is absolutely necessary for us. We have to have a Savior, because without a Savior, we'll never live with God. We'll never go to heaven.
And the one would get
Jesus. Yeah. We would not have a Savior from sin. We'd be so sad. But now at Christmas, we could be happy because we have a Savior, Jesus, who came to die on the cross for us and then to rise again. That's what we're celebrating this Christmas. Okay, you can go back and sit with your parents. We'll sing the hymn of the day, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. Celebration this year, which will begin in just 7 days. What kind of thoughts or emotions are you experiencing right now? Well, on the negative end of the emotions and thought spectrum, maybe you're a little stressed out. You have a ton of things to do, yet, and only 7 days to do them. Maybe you're filled with anxiety. Will things go as you had hoped they would, as you had planned? If you're traveling, especially if you're traveling a great distance, this is winter, and anything can happen. Will your travel plans go as you thought they would, or not? But we try to be positive, don't we? After all, it's Christmas. Like the song says, it's the most wonderful time of the year. And so we're filled with joy over the impending celebration with family and friends. There'll be great things to eat. There will be dazzling displays of lights. There will be gifts given and gifts received. But you and I as Christians know that there's more than that, so much more than that. The celebration of Christmas is a celebration of God coming to us in human flesh and blood, Emmanuel. And it wouldn't be Christmas if we didn't celebrate it, the truth that Christ is God's Emmanuel, our Savior from sin. In his opening words to the letter to the Romans, Paul speaks about that Savior. He helps us focus our attention right where it should be, not on all the trappings of Christmas, but on God's gift to us himself, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In these words, Paul reminds us that Jesus came just as God had promised, just as we expected. Advent promises kept. Let's see what those promises are and how they bless us as we look forward to celebrating our Savior's birth in just a week. Babies. As you know, they're born every day. I took a look on the internet. Supposedly, there are 385,000 babies born every day. And I don't think anyone have ever heard anyone say, babies, you see one, you see them all. We know that every child is a gift. Every child is unique. And to the parent of that child, precious beyond measure. But of all the babies born, your Savior and mine was far different. Paul puts it this way. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, regarding his son, who as to his earthly life was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. In these opening words, Paul introduces himself, Paul, then attaches the word apostle to himself, an apostle of the gospel that was proclaimed beforehand in the Old Testament, the gospel that centers in the person and the work of none other than Jesus Christ. And when Paul mentions Jesus Christ, he breaks into a full description of who the Savior is and what his work would be. Sadly, there are far too many people who will be celebrating Christmas in a week without recognizing the truth about Christ. He is Emmanuel, God with us. Paul doesn't let us forget that truth. As soon as he starts mentioning the Savior, he talks about him as the Son of God. And that's exactly the way God promised he would send that Savior into the world. We heard it earlier. In Isaiah's prophecy, the virgin will be with child and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, God with us. Just a few chapters later in Isaiah, God foretells that the Savior would be called the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Any Jewish person in the Old Testament who took the Old Testament seriously had to know that the Savior was going to be God himself. Advent promises kept. But that's not all. Paul also talks about the fact that Jesus Christ was a descendant of King David, just as God had foretold. Now think about that for a minute. What in the world would cause God to take on human flesh and blood? We call it the incarnation. Why would God do that? Why would God empty himself for a time of his glory and his power and his majesty to take on human flesh and blood, our human flesh and blood? Why would the God who fills all of the universe confine himself to the womb of the Virgin Mary? Why would he do that? Simply because of his love. His eternal love for all human beings. His love for you. God foretold, God promised that the Savior would be a descendant of King David, truly human. Jesus came just that way. Advent promises kept. And since that's who he is, true God and true man, we're confident that he is the world's Savior, your Savior from sin. If Jesus had come into this world simply as true man, then I could never be certain that he's my Savior from sin. If he had only come into this world as true God, then he couldn't have been my substitute and your substitute under God's law and on the cross of Calvary. But as God and man in one person, here he is, our Savior from sin. Advent promises kept. This is Emmanuel, God with us. Think about it. 10 days from now, you're going to be analyzing Christmas 2022. You're going to ask yourself, well, just how did my Christmas go? The younger people among us, did you get what you wanted, what you asked for? The older ones among us, we realize there's very little in life that we need. Very little in life that we truly want. What we truly need, what we probably need, can't be purchased at a store, put into a box, wrapped neatly, and placed under a tree. But none of that really matters. Because none of those things are what God promised us. Instead, he gave the Advent promise that our Savior would be Emmanuel, God with us. And that's what you believe. Think about it. Without faith in Emmanuel, in your heart, you really don't have a life, not life with God. Without faith in Emmanuel, God with us, this life is just a cruel prelude to an eternity separated from God. But God has changed all that because he lived up to his Advent promises. And he sent the Savior into the world just as you needed him to be, true God and true man, your Savior from sin. So no matter how Christmas goes this year for you, you still have that, and that's everything. Advent promises kept through Emmanuel, God with us. Promises kept in your life usually mean that a blessing is coming or has come your way. Someone promised you, I'll be home for Christmas, and that's the way it is. They show up at your doorstep. I promise we'll spend time at our favorite place. And that's what happens, and you're blessed. I promise I'll take care of that for you tomorrow, and lo and behold, that's what happens, and you're blessed. Those are small blessings compared to what your God has in store for you through Emmanuel. Paul speaks of those blessings here in the last portion of our text. He says, through him we have received grace and apostleship to call all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith for his name's sake. And you also are among those Gentiles who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. You have God's grace. Grace is undeserved favor. It's receiving from God what we don't deserve. Do you realize how contrary that is to the way things work in our world? In the world, it's all merit. You earn what you get. Not with your God, it's all grace. He gives you what you don't deserve because of who he is, the God of grace. He wants you to spend eternal life with him. He wants you to be certain of the forgiveness of all of your sins. He wants you to be sure that you're a member of his family by faith in Jesus Christ. And it's not something you do on your own. It's all God's doing by grace. And because of that grace, you have peace. Not the world's kind of peace, but peace with God. You don't have to wonder how God feels about you. You don't have to wonder what you need to do in order for God to smile upon you. You already know that Christ has done everything. Your sins have been washed away. Your guilt is atoned for. Jesus has made you one with God. He has nothing against you. You stand before him in the perfection or the holiness of Christ by faith in him. Peace with God. Paul shares one final word of Advent comfort. He says, and you also are among those called to belong to Jesus Christ. Life around us seems to change at the speed of light. What we counted on yesterday isn't available today. We wonder what's going to happen tomorrow. We're insecure about so many aspects of our lives, but not about this one. Paul says, as a Gentile, you were called to belong to Jesus Christ. It's what his work was all about, to redeem you, to make you his own, to pay the price that was demanded, that you belong to him forever. It's all God's doing through Emmanuel. Advent promises kept through Emmanuel, resulting in grace and peace for you. What is Christmas peace? I'm sure you're going to hear quite a few definitions in the week ahead. For some people, Christmas peace is that warm, fuzzy feeling they get as they spend time during the holiday with their family and friends. But it only lasts as long as those family and friends are there. Once they depart, it fades away. Others think Christmas peace is that feeling that people have of being generous at this time of year, taking care of those less fortunate. But that too tends to fade, doesn't it? The peace of God, which Jesus has won for you, is not dependent upon your outward circumstances. Your circumstance in life can be dire, critical, and yet you still have the peace that Christ won for you. Peace between you and the Holy God, solely through the work of Emmanuel, God with us. Advent promises kept through Emmanuel, resulting in your grace and peace. I'm sure you're going to be busy the next few days. Busy trying to make Christmas what you want it to be. But don't forget this one thing. You can't make it any better than your God has already made it for you, because he kept every one of his promises to you. Advent promises kept through Emmanuel, resulting in your grace and peace. Focus on that great truth as you continue to prepare your hearts for the celebration of the birth of your Savior. Amen. Please stay. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Having heard the word of our God, we now make confession of the Christian faith using the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Even though Christmas is a week away, we still mourn. We mourn the fact of death. This last week, the Lord called home to himself in heaven the soul of our member Dale Selves. We'll pray for the Lord to comfort Esther and Caleb and the rest of us who are mourning his passing. We also mourn the passing of Lucas Wagner, relative of the Beer family. He was assisting a motorist who was in an accident on an interstate when another car slammed into him and took his life. And finally, we'll join in praying for God to comfort Marcus Ketchpole's neighbor, who was the father of the young Fairborn High School girl who was killed in an auto accident on Friday. Almighty God and Father, we thank you for all your mercies, especially for the gift of your Son, through whom you have revealed your gracious will. We praise you for the Holy Spirit and his working through the means of grace. Plant your word in our hearts and cause it to produce fruit in our lives. Strengthen and defend your church, that by your word and sacraments, faith may grow and love toward all may increase.
Support all who spread the light of your truth throughout the world.
Keep our children in the grace of their baptisms. Enable their parents to train them in lives of faith.
Raise up Christians to serve you in the ministry of the word and all godly walks of life.
Preserve our nation in justice and honor. Guide and bless all who make, administer, and judge our laws.
Give them wisdom that they may promote justice and hinder evil.
Let your blessing rest on planting and harvest, commerce and industry, medicine and science, the arts and culture. Protect all who travel and care for those whose work is difficult or dangerous.
Be with all who devote themselves to any useful task.
Comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. Remember those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those for whom death draws near.
Grant them your love and take them into your tender care.
O Lord God, Lord of life and death, we thank you for all the mercies with which you have shown our fellow believers now fallen asleep. We thank you especially for having brought them to the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would comfort their families and all who mourn their deaths with your precious promises, and cheer them with the sure hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. We ask that you would remind us that we'll enjoy a joyful reunion in heaven. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain hearts of wisdom and finally be saved. Through Jesus Christ, our risen and ever-living Lord. Hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. We remember with thanksgiving those who loved and served you who now rest from their labors. Console those who are mourning or living with sadness. Keep us in the true faith and bring us at last to the joys of heaven. Grant us these things, Father, for the sake of Jesus, who died and rose again. Amen. The congregation may be seated for the offering. Salvation, full and free, my pardon and my love. Great gifts I brought for thee. Come, bring thy gifts to me. Amen. We'll continue singing the next hymn, The Angel Gabriel from Heaven Came. The first two stanzas are accompanied by the organ. The second two, the stanzas 3 and 4, we'll sing a cappella.
His wings has drifted so.
please stand for prayer and the benediction. Blessed Lord, you have given us your holy scriptures for our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for the closing hymn. If you have a few minutes yet, I'd like you to stay and view this month's edition of the Wells Connection. Wells Connection is a video that our synod produces, showing what the synod is doing with the offerings in our congregation and the rest of the congregations in the synod are doing with them. After that, I'll have a couple of announcements for you.
Merry Christmas. I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. Wells is incredibly blessed to be able to send missionaries out into the various parts of North America and the whole world to preach the good news of Christ to all creation. And although that invitation to do so from Jesus himself is an exciting one, it can also come with challenges. That's why the support that Wells members from across our Synod give to our missionaries and their families is so vital.
Pastor Andrew Johnston serves as a Wells World missionary with his wife Cindy and their five children. Just weeks after their third child was born in Antigua, the newborn ran a fever.
When little guys get fevers, it's usually some, you know, they worry about it because it could be some really serious stuff.
So Cindy brought her baby to the local hospital to see the pediatrician. They ran tests on him and did some blood work.
So, you know, obviously as a mom, you're just worried. I'm looking at the tests they're running and the blood work they're doing and everything they're doing, and I'm saying, oh my goodness, is this right? Is this what we should be doing?
So, for some confirmation, Cindy was connected with a Wells member in the United States who is also a pediatrician.
So I'm sending him test results and sending him, you know, all the medications they were prescribing and the dosages and everything they were doing just to double check. A lot of the physicians there were very, very good and definitely knew their stuff. But, you know, you just worry because it's different.
Being outside of our comfort zone can certainly be worrisome at times. But thanks be to God, in the end, the Johnston son was okay and his fever passed. But Cindy says she's extremely thankful for the support that Wells members provided to her family.
It was just an unbelievable blessing to be able to text him throughout the process and throughout everything and just, you know, get his encouragement and his support and his confirmation.
Sometimes that support happens on an individual level. And other times, it happens on a larger scale, such as at gatherings of the Lutheran Women's Missionary Society, or LWMS.
Wells missionaries trekked to Africa in 1953 and established a church in the country we now call Zambia.
Or at Taste of Missions, held at Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary.
Vicki!
I am super excited about the work. It's never fun to be excited about something and have other people shrug their shoulders. So when you go to something like an LWMS convention or Taste of Missions, it is such encouragement to be around people who are just as excited as I am about the work of the gospel in other places.
I mean, we've got so many people who are supporting us in this work, and it just feels really good to know that they're behind us and praying for us and eager to see us succeed, you know, as we go with God's word.
LWMS and Taste of Missions are wonderful ways that members of Wells churches can learn about various mission work that Wells is doing both in North America and around the world, directly from those who are in the field.
You're hearing the missionaries talk about their work. That's really not easy work. You know, they don't have individuals welcome them all the time. Sharing Jesus is not necessarily something that is welcomed in specific countries or even here in the United States at times.
Sometimes our missionaries are on islands preaching the good news. Other times, it might feel like they are on spiritual islands, working in a culture and society that is so distant from God. But through the encouragement and enthusiasm of supporters, these missionaries and their families can, God willing, feel a little less alone.
That enthusiasm is kind of contagious. This huge group of people that's just standing behind you and supporting and singing their guts out. It's just so cool to be a part of that.
Support of these missionaries is so beneficial because their work is so vital that others might know of the peace and hope that only Jesus brings.
To everyone in the pew, to everyone who gives offerings, gives prayers, sends a letter to a missionary, befriends a mission, anyone who does that, just thank you, because it does not go unnoticed. It is so, so appreciated. And I always felt like a number of times over the years, you know, that letter came at just the right time. You know, where you were struggling or having trouble with something, and and it just showed up, and it's super cool. So thank you very, very much.
Supporting missionaries, their families, and their work can happen in many different ways, such as attending one of these events, writing them a personalized message of encouragement, praying for their work, and supporting financially through your gifts. We thank you for all of the ways that you support Wells Mission Work, and if you'd like to learn more about how you can join these important efforts, visit wells.net/missions.
Thank you for staying and watching that, but most of all, thanks for being with me here in God's house, hearing God's promises of a Savior, promises fulfilled in our Savior Jesus Christ. It's been a pleasure for me to share that message with you, especially if you're visiting with us today. Just announcement, we have Christmas services, 7 o'clock Christmas Eve, 10 o'clock Christmas Day. You're all welcome and encouraged to attend. Join us in praising our God for keeping his promise of sending a Savior from sin. And we just have one more announcement. That's from Mark Beer. Our financial secretary has got an opportunity for you if that's something you're interested in. Go ahead, Mark.
Yes, we have the potential to offer Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University course. It's a wonderful course. It deals with money and financial management, setting a budget, and they're offering many pathways to get out of debt. Once you have financial stability to grow your wealth to live the rest of your life with a little bit of peace. If you're interested, it's a 10-week course. We're looking to start it in late January or mid-January. So if you're interested or have family or friends that might be interested, please drop Pastor or myself a line, email, text. I'll even take a little note on a Christmas cookie to get your reservations. So let me know, and we'll start rolling out the plan if we have some interest in it. Any questions? All right, thank you very much.
Thanks, Mark. Have a blessed day.